Hi, I'm Pastor Aaron. Thanks for letting us into your home. We love singing together. I hope that you sing out. Are you singing out? You nudge the person next to you, say, sing out when it's time to sing. I really love sharing the word with you and prayer, opening up opportunities. And that's what we're going to do again today. There's a lot going on, and you can check our website for all of these things. You can give and connect and care there using those links on our website. There's also an elder nomination form that you, as a member of the church, can use there at issaquah.cc/elder. And there's an opportunity to nominate for that position as well. So there's a lot going on. I'm going to have Angela share a little bit about what you can do to care.
Hi, this is Angela, and I'm really excited to see you signing up on our care page. This is going to give us a huge opportunity to bring food to people who need it and to bless those who are really going through a hard time right now. So what we're doing is we're coordinating care teams in a number of special ways. And what we need is for you to use your gifting, your special abilities, whatever's been put on your heart to help those who really need it right now. And if you haven't already, you can visit issaquah.cc/care and fill out the partnership form. And I just thank you so much, and God bless you, and have a blessed week.
Thanks, Angela. You can check your email, and if you don't have access to that or you don't get the newsletter, then go to our main page on their website and scroll down to the bottom and put in your email address, and you'll get the newsletter every week. It's packed full this week of all sorts of ministry opportunities that we can engage in during this pandemic. So I want to encourage you to read through that and click through it. There's a lot of participation needed from you, including I need you to send to me all sorts of videos of you reading a psalm, of you reading a prayer, of you and your family maybe, reading a story of Jesus, saying hello to people that are trapped in senior living apartments, for instance. We're going to get messages out to them and have these really cool opportunities to be able to do that. So help me out and help us get the word out to all of these people that are isolated right now. That's an amazing opportunity that God's opened up to us to share the love in that way. So I want to encourage you to send those into me. So this morning we're going to sing again, sing out. We're going to sing a couple songs, and then I'm going to give a message from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 10. And then we'll have another song. We'll have a time of communion. So prepare, send someone to get those elements now. If you've got grape juice, that should be an essential item for the church, right? You need to make sure that's an essential item on your shopping list. Grape juice and some crackers or bread for our communion time. And then we'll close with another song. And Jared and Linnea are going to lead us in that. So just take a moment and say, Jesus, would you open my heart to you? Because I know, Jesus, your heart is open to me.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began.
child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Hi, this is Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14 in the Message Bible. How blessed is God, and what a blessing He is. He's the Father of our Master Jesus Christ, and takes us to the high places of blessings in Him. Long before He laid down earth's foundations, He had us in mind, had settled on us as the focus of His love, to be made whole and holy by His love. Long, long ago, He decided to adopt us into His family through Jesus Christ. And what a pleasure He took in planning this. He wanted us to enter into the celebration of His lavish gift-giving by the hand of His beloved Son. Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, His blood poured out on the altar of the cross, we are a free people, free of penalties and punishments chalked up by all of our misdeeds. And not just barely free either. Abundantly free. He thought of everything, provided everything we could possibly need, letting us in on the plans He took such a delight in making. He set it all out before us in Christ, a long-range plan in which everything would be brought together and summed up in Him, everything in deepest heaven, everything on planet Earth. It's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, He had His eye on us. Had designs on us for glorious living, part of the overall purpose He is working out in everything and everyone. It's in Christ that you, once you heard the truth and believed it, this message of your salvation, found yourselves home free, signed, sealed, and delivered by the Holy Spirit. This signet from God is the first installment of what's coming, a reminder that we'll get everything God has planned for us, a praising and glorious life. Be blessed.
Home is where the heart is. So I want to ask you, where do you feel most at home? Where would you like to be other than in your house during this quarantine? Where would you like to be? You could be honest with me. Don't tell some other people. Some homes are toxic right now. They're full of anxious people trying to grab some sense of control out of a a really messed up situation. There are so many variables to consider, and there are so many opinions flying around. People are reaching out to grab some amount of control, and it seems like they're grabbing each other by the neck. You have a different opinion than me, so you are terrible. You know all sorts of stuff. Wow, that's going on out there. The church needs to be different. Our homes should be different. Our homes shouldn't be toxic, right? But home is where the heart is, and I'll tell you, sometimes my mind goes elsewhere. Man, I wish I was there right now. I'm so used to having some sort of exciting plans for the future. Something on the horizon that makes life seem a little bit spiced. This plotting is terrible on my mental health. I'm telling you the truth. I wouldn't be surprised if tomorrow I woke up and it was December. You're like, time to put up the Christmas lights, I guess, right? I mean, just my life just feels so mundane and so ordinary right now, and I need something out there. And what's wonderful is my father-in-law, Heather's dad, has provided for us to go to Cabo San Lucas, Mexico, multiple times. And every time I go, I sit down on the beach, stare at the ocean, and just absorb sounds, and then try to remember when I come back home and close my eyes and imagine myself there. In fact, there's a spot on my upper deck that gets just enough warmth. It could be a 50 degree day out, but if the sun is out, I can get warm and it's covered by the wind. And so I can feel that warmth going up. And sometimes my kids will be like, "Oh, Dad, are you going to Cabo?" I'm like, "Yep, I got my nachos. I got my sparkling water. I got my shorts on, and I'm ready to just go to Cabo, right? I'm gonna go to my happy place and just kind of imagine, right? And those are kind of my comfort foods, and I get there and I'm kind of home. So home is where the heart is. So what do you do when, you know, what do I do when vacation plans fail? When you can't really feel at home in your own family, your relationships are so toxic or messed up. What about when you can't feel at home in your own skin? You just need to get out of here, but here is there. Wherever you go, there you are, and you can't seem to escape that aspect of it. Maybe your home is in a hospital right now, or a senior living apartment, or a nursing home. Or maybe your home is more panic, anxiety, misery. So I just want you to think about that. Where do you feel most at home? Because you have been invited, and today you are being invited into a different home, and that home is Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah. You know, we talked about this last week, but creation was meant to be a home where we would find fullness and satisfaction and unity and love. And we discussed this last week. You can go back and look, but that was broken. But the new creation was launched in the resurrection of Jesus. Something brand new was happening. Heaven and earth are soon to be united. And they were intersected in Jesus. Heaven and earth, the location, the temple space, the place where you would go to connect with God on earth is the God-man, Jesus Christ. He is home. New creation also shows up in this new family, with God as Father, a Father who lavishly blesses His children. He does so in part so that we can display His lavish generosity to others as we participate in this new creation lifestyle, as this new creation human family. And so today in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 10, we're going to see how this prisoner, messenger, apostle Paul says home is in the Messiah. It's in the work of the Messiah. But Paul is not living his best version. He's not on vacation right now. He's a prisoner. He's not in Cabo. He's in prison for announcing that Jesus is the completion of the Jewish story. So he's the king of the Jews, but also the king of the world. That's an important announcement. It messed with a lot of people. They weren't happy about it. So what do we know about this home? Well, let's just look at this father in verse 3 through 6, the father. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus, the King, who has blessed us in the Christ, in the Messiah, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless or unblemished before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption into this family through Jesus, the Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has blessed us in the beloved. This is our Father. Do you want to get to know him? Well, you're going to find him, and you're going to get to know him in the person of Christ. He's a God who is not holding back. He's not stingy. He's giving us every blessing. In fact, he has arranged it so all of heaven's resources are for you, so that you can lavishly, generously give in that same way, the love that he wants to pour out through you. And it says here, he chose us. This is Jews and Gentiles. This is the people of God and then the new people of God, Israel and new Israel. He chose us before the foundation of the world. No, he chose Eden, and then we messed it up, and then the divine family rebelled, and the human family rebelled, and then he had to put it all back. No, he chose us before the foundation of the world. Put that mystery into your head. This is the way? No, this is... God was going to become man and suffer and die? Yeah, that's the way it was supposed to be. Before the foundation of the world. When Jesus was explaining to his disciples after his resurrection, no. Remember, I must die. That's the whole point of this. I must come and suffer, draw sin and evil onto myself and have it punished in my body. Right? Don't you understand that? I'm like, no, we don't understand that. But if we listen back to what he said, remember he said, this project to unite everything in him, back in God, where God and man intersect, where heaven and earth intersect. This plan from before the world began was that the Son of Man must come to give his life as a ransom for many. He said, this is the bread that I will give. It's my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be slain. Even so, the Son of Man must be lifted up. And if I'm lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men to me. For this cause, I came to this hour. You see this all throughout the Gospels. So this is what the Father has done. He has done this in us. He has predestined us for adoption. He has chosen us in the Messiah. So it's in the Messiah. And that's what we need to think about. So we've got the Father, and now we need to think about what it means to be in the Messiah. It says we're blessed in Christ, in this royal figure, this king figure, who now we see embodies God himself among us to rule and reign in his new creation. This Messiah, we're blessed in Christ. And if you look at this passage, it's full of in Christ, in him, in Christ. That's our home. In him. That's where we can find ourselves. But more importantly than ourselves, that's where we can find God the Father, because we are in Christ the Son, the Messiah. It says we've been chosen in him, predestined. This is the plan, chosen in him, the chosen one and the chooser. The Messiah is the elect one, is the chosen one. is the anointed one, and he's the one who does the choosing, the elect and the elector. Now, election and this predestination, this election has a backstory that you need to understand. We've got to understand this. And I'll tell you, you're so lucky. You don't need a theological handbook to figure this out. Election has a backstory, and it's in the story of Israel. Remember, out of all the nations, God chose Abraham and Sarah to create a family. And all the nations were dispersed. They were worshiping other gods, divine beings that had rebelled, that did a really poor job of governing their nations. We see that in Psalm 82 and Psalm 89. Their rule has to be extracted from them. God himself will come and rule, right? So these beings have control over these other nations, but not Israel. No, never. Israel is going to have one God, Yahweh, alone, and love him with all your heart and soul and mind and strength, right? So they've been chosen for God to be among them. So they have to be careful about this, because the one true God, the creator of everything, is in their midst. What a wonder this is. What a light to the rest of the world this is. And so their job was very, very important. So if God himself is going to be in their midst, it means they have direct access to him, his teaching, and his worship. That's ultimately what election means. Election means, at its simplest level, that Israel alone had direct access to the true God and his true worship. So a question I always get so often. So does elect, if I've been elected, does that equal salvation? Okay, because everybody wants to know. I made a decision in the past. Does it count for the future? I made a decision, or somebody that's close to you maybe has died, and you're like, okay, but they made a decision in the past. Does that mean that still counts even if their lives don't show it in the future? This question comes up all the time. So does election equal salvation? Now, pick your framework, you know. You and look around you, you all have various opinions. You've maybe grown up in different theological traditions. You probably have a theological framework to attempt to answer this. But again, let's just look at Israel. Let's just look at the story. Without committing to a particular theological, you know, trend, let's take a look at it. Was all Israel chosen? Well, yeah, of course, all Israel was chosen. That's what that means. They were the God's inheritance, his portion, his elect ones, his chosen people. So was all Israel chosen? Yes, of course. They had access to the true God and true worship. But was all Israel saved? Well, no, of course not. Many were excluded from the community by sending them out. Others worshipped these false gods as well, these divine beings, and were sent away from the community. Ultimately, Israel got banished from their own land because they had worshipped these other gods. And except for the remnant who continued to worship Yahweh and Yahweh alone, those people would have been lost. We wouldn't say that they were saved if they worshipped other gods, because you can worship one God and one God alone. So I think we can say this. Was all Israel saved? Well, how about this? We could say this definitively. There are no Baal worshipers in heaven. That's a Canaanite deity. There are no Ashtoreth worshipers in heaven. There are no Diana and Artemis, you know, worshipers in heaven. No. You have to believing loyalty is how you are saved. So election, it's not like the upcoming election where we just pick and choose and that's the way it goes. Election has a backstory, and it's in the people of Israel. And so we need to understand that. You shall have no other gods before me. Israel was supposed to carry this banner, bearing the name of Yahweh that they bring to the Gentiles, okay, to the rest of the world. So true believers worship Yahweh, okay? So election does not equal salvation. Election is access to the teaching and to the community and to God's presence himself. So that's what we know from the story of Israel. I don't believe that can be proven wrong Though it may kind of upset your theological framework, that's just a truism. And I've been asked this question hundreds of times before. So can a believer lose his salvation? Is a believer eternally secure? Okay, and so there's so much going on with the question, and there's so much lack of knowledge that I would probably dare not answer that question with a lot of authority, but instead I would ask this question. Which of these statements would you deny if you're worried about the losing of salvation or eternal security? Okay, here's pretty exact statement, so I'll get them for you. Everyone who believes the gospel will be saved by grace and not by any merit of their own. Yeah? Yeah, that's right. Okay, everyone who believes the gospel will be eternally secure. Yeah. Okay, we're the same. Okay, everyone who does not believe the gospel, or rejects it, will not be saved regardless of works, regardless of their efforts, because they reject the gospel. Yeah? Yeah, okay, yeah. Everyone who does not believe the gospel will not be eternally secure. If you don't believe the good news that God is uniting heaven and earth under King Jesus, and that his resurrection proves that he was this Messiah, and that he has all authority in heaven and earth, and we are to organize our lives around that principle. If you don't believe that, you will not be eternally secure. And I'm just going to let God be the judge on that. So that question, can a believer lose his salvation? Once saved, always saved. Is a believer eternally secure? I would just rather talk about those statements and leave a little bit of that mystery to God. Okay, so one thing that the Father has done, remember it says he adopted us into his family. And it's through Jesus that we are adopted. It says he predestined us for adoption through Jesus Christ according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has blessed us in the beloved. And now let's look at these next verses, these four verses, about what we have in Christ. In him, this is the beloved, this is in Christ, we have redemption through his blood. Redemption. This is straight up Exodus language, Passover language. The blood of the Lamb covers our sin, provides our way of escape. We are no longer slaves. We have been redeemed. We have been bought back. We are now in Christ. We have made our home in Christ. We have redemption through his blood. We have the forgiveness of our trespasses. We have forgiveness. We indwell forgiveness. Forgiveness indwells us. We are forgiven of our sin. According to the riches of his grace, his amazing riches, his desire to pour out unmerited favor on us, this gift that we do not deserve, comes in Jesus. He lavished those riches upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. We are chosen and rescued and adopted and blessed. Why? Oh, mysterious, but for his good pleasure. He loves you. He's not holding out on you. His desire for you right now is to be drawn into him, into his Father's heart for you. Not like the dad you knew. He's the dad we should all have had. Someone who lavishly blesses and pours out riches and grace and love. That's what you need. You don't deserve it, neither do I, but he loves you and wants to draw you into his family. Will you say yes to him? Will you? Say yes in the comments. we'll connect with you. Go to our website and use the connect page, issaquah.cc/connect, and say, yeah, I want to follow Jesus. Show me what it looks like to live in this new household. I want to find my home in Jesus. Absolutely. It's for his good pleasure. God is rich in kindness and mercy. And he's enacted a plan to bring everything back together in Jesus, the Messiah, Christ, our King. So we've talked about the mission. We talked about the Father. We've talked about the Messiah. And now we need to talk about the mission. So then what? If this has all been done for us, how are we supposed to live? Isn't it interesting that it says here that salvation isn't the end of the story? For a lot of us, we're like, phew, so you convinced me that if I believe the gospel, I'm saved. And if I'm a person that believes in the gospel, I am eternally secure. Awesome. Great. Phew, I'm done. Like, no. It says here, it's a part of the process. We have redemption, which he has lavished according to his purpose as a plan for the fullness of time. It's part of the plan. It's not the end of the story. It's absolutely essential, but it's not the end. The plan is to bring it all together, all of heaven and earth. These fractured relationships that we have are meant to be brought together in Christ. How? Well, get Christ in you. Ask him, Christ, would you be real to me? Jesus, would you indwell me? Would you reshape my life? I want to find my home in you. And please make your home in me. As we do that, we become different people. That we can even see this now. We begin to see things unite in heaven and on earth under Jesus. We see that happening in our relationships now. We're so divided right now. We're divided over stay-at-home orders or back to work. And people are pulling out their hair. They're enraged. I'm unfollowing people all the time. I don't need to hear that. Great, you have an opinion. Well, so do I. But it doesn't mean I'm going to trash you because you have an opinion. It's ridiculous out there. Even churches are separated right now. You know, who's going to be the first church to get back in and win the game or something like that? There's so much suspicion and so much indifference, even within and between churches, that we need a word from Jesus right now. We need to get on mission. Do you realize this? We are forgiven. Did you read that? Did you hear that? We are forgiving. We are forgiven. We are forgiving. We are in a household of grace and forgiveness. It's not a toxic household. We should know better. We're growing up in the faith in a house where the Father has lavished upon us every rich blessing and every grace. We're a different people. Do you know who is unforgiving and unforgiven? Demons. The Satan. These divine rebellious beings. And it says, in your anger, don't give a foothold to Satan. And in your bitterness and unforgiveness, don't give a foothold to Satan. In your biting and devouring, you are being influenced by the demonic. Okay, I didn't need to hear that. You maybe did. You maybe need to know that there is an influence in our society and in our minds right now that is moving us toward what's natural, and what's natural is not grace. What's natural is not forgiveness. Demons are unforgiven and they are unforgiving. Jesus is creating a people who are forgiven and forgiving. And this is all through the grace of God. So grace and peace to you. Church, we need to watch our words. We got to watch the way we speak. Now, everybody out there is trying to do their best, I think. No one's trying to make anybody else's life miserable, trying to kill people or trying to do... Nobody's trying to do that, But we need to figure out a way for our opinions to be communicated in a helpful way. Grace and peace to you. As a church, I mean, for example, on social media, do people experience kindness and grace along with your opinion? Did you give your opinion to vent or to provide hope? Well, let's follow Jesus, love Jesus, and also follow in the way of Jesus. Bless and do not curse, right? This is just one aspect of how we can live out this mission of living in this household called forgiveness. Can you imagine Jesus sitting around with his inner circle at the end of a long day of ministry, bashing the idiots they talk to during the day? Oh man, did you see that one kid? He had the stupidest question. That's not the way the world's going to work. The way the world's going to work is we're going to blah, 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 blah. Can you imagine Jesus letting that go on? No. So here's just a caution. Most of you are fine. Don't worry about this. But here's a caution. If your heart isn't full of the love of Jesus, then be careful what you share. If your heart's full of the love of Jesus, share away. It'll come across. People will experience it as kindness and love. So that's fine. But the gospel is something that works throughout our homes, throughout our lives. And it should come out in our words, and certainly the way we're in our social media time right now, it's got to work out. We have all heaven working for us to pour out this grace. Okay, so this is what I want you to do as we close. Would you just imagine Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, being enough for you in this moment to be home for you in this moment? And we can live it out as his family, as people who have been lavished with gifts and grace and mercy and forgiveness. And then we can be those kind of people who pour that out.
My Jesus, I love. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
And praise thee as long as thou hast lendest me breath.
And say, when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus.
again, gladly forever adore Him.
Every good thing that we have from God our Father, which is lavished upon us, is in Christ. And as we take communion today, I've got some grape juice and a fish cracker. And hopefully you've got your elements too, but let me pray a blessing on those elements. Father God, you have poured out everything for us. You are all for us. And we invite you to make your home in us as individuals, in our families, as a church. Make your home in us. And we, Lord Jesus, want to make our home in you, to be found in you. And so as we partake in communion, in the mystery of having you incorporated in us, would you bless these elements and would you unite us together and unite us with you, even as you are uniting everything under the Messiah. He said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup, this cup that represents his blood, which cleanses us from all sin, which purifies us, which makes us the blameless, unblemished, holy people that God sees us to be. He said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Drink it." As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. We love you. Make your home in us as we make our home in you.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand.
In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the love of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, but with the precious blood of Christ.
Church, thank you so much for being with us today. Remember, we're going to meet right afterward on Zoom to share, discuss, pray together. So you'll find those links below. May God richly bless you and may God be with you until we meet again.
Good morning, ICC family. This is Dan. Hey, woke up at 3:33 this morning and this was on my heart and I thought it was probably a good time to retell my miracle story. Back in 2009, I had gone to my cardiologist and found out that a previous open heart surgery repair of my heart valve was not working, so I needed to have a new aortic valve replaced. At that time also, when I got a CT, they discovered there was an aortic aneurysm, which was called ascending aortic aneurysm, I guess. And I was pretty confident God was in charge, but I'm telling you what, when I heard that they might have to freeze my brain, I was a bit concerned at that point. So once we absorbed that, Becky and I cried a little bit together and thought it over that following Sunday, came to church. Issaquah Christian Church, and basically asked my church family to pray over me, and they actually laid hands and a group of people prayed on me. It was pretty darn touching. I could feel the Holy Spirit moving throughout me and the room and those folks that were involved. So amazing amount of love and hugs, and I truly felt God was involved in the unity of this family and coming together to support Becky and I in this challenging time. Well, so as I moved forward and the day of surgery came about, I got to the parking lot and there's this gang of people from ICC waiting there. They got to the hospital before I did the day of my surgery. I'm going, whoa, this is cool. They love me. They truly love me. So I get in there, they get me all prepped for surgery. And I think they must have prayed with me three different times. Pastor Brad anointed me with oil two times. I was pretty amazed. I was peaceful, at peace, and calm, because the great thing about being a Christian is when we depart here, I know there's a really good place waiting for me up in heaven. Now, I also found out about ICC family that the day of my surgery, they had opened the church up, and some folks I didn't know were in the church praying for me about this surgery. When the doc went in, put the new cow valve in, and then went to go repair the aneurysm, it had shrank about to half the size that it was under all these pictures and all these films, and they didn't have to freeze my brain, and all was well with that part. The surgery went absolutely wonderful. When I woke up, of course, it took a little while to recovery, but the surgeon himself told me how amazed everything went and how this aneurysm had shrunk in size, and thus the miracle, thus the power of prayer, thus my ICC family coming together, praying over me, God stepping in and say, I'm going to fix this. God's miracles, they're happening every day for us. They're happening beside us and around us, and sometimes we may not even recognize it as a miracle of this size. But this is a story of a miracle that I hadn't shared, and it was amazing because God woke me up at 3:33 in the morning and said, guess what, Dan, you need to retell this story, because it is about family, it's about love, it's about caring, it's about grace, as I've been taught, and it's also about coming together in unity as one body who we all have this in common. We love Jesus Christ, and we all want to do his work and share his story. Anyway, I am a miracle. God has performed miracles. I thank him for it. I sometimes forget about it, but he woke me up this morning and reminded me to share this with you, that he is alive, he is well, and he can and will perform miracles. We just got to get on our knees and pray. As a church, we need to come together as one. One body, one God's church body that loves him and express it with each other, share it with each other, love each other. And I love you guys, and I thank you for hearing me tell this story that I probably need to tell a little bit more often, but God is good. Bless you all. Take care.